Hi. As you can see, I've put up there science and the media, fitting a square peg in a round hole. And as I talk, I hope it will become obvious why I'm saying that. So, the journey, where are we going to go? Going to look at who the main players are when we talk about science and the media. How does the media work? How does science work? A bit of a think about why we need science coverage in the first place. Criticisms of science and the media. Alternatives to where we are at the moment, how things are changing. And who controls what science appears in the media. And then the future, how on earth are we going to fund continued science in the media? So, the main players, who have we got? We've got the scientists. They do the science that the media report on. You've then got scientific bodies, places like the RI. You've got government. They might fund science, develop science policy, put on events just like this that then create coverage in the media. You then have press officers. They sit between the science and the journalists. They kind of interpret what the scientists are doing and sell it to the media. And that's a job that I've had, so that's been one of my main jobs, is doing that job in the middle there. And at the end of the day, key to the media, at the heart of the media, are the journalists, and they're the ones who actually do the job of reporting on the science, interviewing the scientists, and presenting it to the public. Okay, so the media. What's the media all about? Short time scale, simple messages, clear-cut yes or no answers, focus on disagreement and exceptions at its basis. Science. Long time scale, complicated messages, no hard and fast answers, and it works on consensus. So already you can see it's quite different. What the media wants is very different from how science works. They're kind of at opposite poles. So are they completely incompatible? And Quentin Cooper, who presents Material World on BBC Radio 4, I just thought this was a really nice quote. He was saying to me, science values detail, precision, the impersonal, the technical, the lasting, facts, numbers, and being right. Journalism values brevity, approximation, the personal, the colloquial, the immediate, stories, words, and being right now. And that there are going to be tensions. But can we overcome these tensions? And you can see there's a completely blank slide there. Because I was starting to think about, why do we need science media coverage in the first place? Why do we need science out there on TV, in the newspapers, on the internet? And I originally had put down a number of points as to why we might need it, but then I suddenly thought, actually, that's something that you should be thinking about, is what is the purpose of it? If it's so diametrically opposed, why do we need it in the first place? And just listening to Hugh was making me think, already I can think of a thousand reasons how we'd know about all the stuff that Hugh was talking about if it wasn't for the media. But anyway, I left that one blank rather than giving you all the answers because I thought that was my job. So, criticisms of science coverage. And it does come under quite a deal of criticism, particularly from scientists themselves. They would say that the coverage distorts the facts. It's quite arbitrary. What ends up in the newspapers isn't really representative of what's going on out in the world of science. Kill or cure sensationalism. And we've all seen this kind of thing where one day chocolate is good for you, the next day it gives you cancer. You know, it's the same things. Do one thing one day, something the other day. Dumbing down, the science is made so simple as to actually making it wrong. In the end, it's just completely wrong. And perpetuating the idea of novelty and breakthrough. So the way it's reported is that science just happens in these small bursts of we know this, we know this, we now know this. When in fact, that isn't how science works. It's a much more gradual process of coming to consensus. So, also criticism of science journalists and what they do. There's a big criticism about false conflict, dressing it up as balance. So if we take the example of the environment, climate change, you put two people up against each other. Somebody who says, you know, climate change, it's all down to humans. And then somebody who says, actually, no, it was nothing to do with us. Vast consensus of opinion on one side, tiny minority in the other, but put up against each other as though they're yes and no, in the same way that you might do with politicians. That kind of model doesn't really work for science. Packed journalism, where science journalists all cover the same stories. You look in the papers today, if there's a science story, it'll be in all the papers, it'll be on the news. They're all covering the same stuff. They're not digging out their own stories, which is where we come to churnalism, which is a great term for journalists just churning out stories. They get the press release, they just completely regurgitate it. They don't even ring up to get their own quotes. They don't even dig a bit deeper. They don't see if there's anybody who's saying, hang on a minute, this isn't quite right. They churn it out. And so at the end of the day, people are saying science journalists, they're no longer being journalists. Now, what does this all matter? My son was quite concerned that wouldn't be big enough. I think that's quite big. It's a cartoon from the States, but I just quite liked it. You start out with your scientist. Here he is saying, oh, A is correlated with B, given C, assuming D, under E conditions. So there's a bit of a relationship between A and B, but there's all these little caveats. But then it goes to the press office. They put out a press release about it. They're quite good about it because they say they find a potential link and they're under certain conditions. By the time it gets into the news, onto the internet, A causes B. Then A causes B all the time. What will this mean for Obama? Sorry, this is an American slide. Then it gets onto the local news. What you don't know about A can kill you. A, the killer amongst us. At the end of the day, your grandma comes back to you as a scientist saying, I'm wearing this hat to ward off A. So you can see how something that starts out quite measured goes through the cycle and comes out black and white, A causes B. So what? So what does this really matter if it's not completely accurate, if the media kind of misinterpret it to fit into their model? Well, it's worst. You can have serious consequences for public health. The example of MMR, where there were a number of reports all about the fact that the MMR vaccination would lead to autism. And there was, in the end, a big drop in the number of children having the vaccination, a rise in the number of measles cases, and it did have an effect on health. So that is quite, you know, so that's quite a serious effect. But what about non-health stories? Stories about physics or chemistry, for example. Does it really matter if the public don't understand the full nitty-gritty of scientific research and if it's all slightly wrong? And is it the job of the media to be educating the public in any case? Is that really their role? Now, what's an alternative scenario? And this is something that's happening at the moment. Scientists going out there talking direct to the public via blogs, via podcasts, the opportunities the internet has given to us. And scientific bodies doing exactly that same thing. They create their own news, so they produce their own news about their own work. And this is already, as I say, happening here and in the States. But think about this. Isn't that just self-serving publicity by organisations with their own agenda to promote what they're doing? What best serves the public interest? Are we better served by journalists doing the job of journalism, investigating, criticising, getting to the truth, or by scientists and scientific institutions telling their own story, so hearing it from the horse's mouth? Also, another thing to think about, who controls what appears in the media? The stories that are out there today, who is actually sort of making sure some stories there and some aren't? Is it the media itself, or is it the science establishment? And who serves the public interest better, if the scientists are in control or if the media are in control? Now, there's been a bit of a shift here over the years, and it used to be very much that the media were the gatekeepers of the science that ended up out there. But now, because there's a number of issues I've put here, there's probably all sorts of different factors involved in this. Multi-platform coverage. Journalists used to just have to write a story. They now write a story, they have to blog on it, they have to do a video, they have to sing the theme tune, write the theme tune. There's just so much more for them to do. They don't have time to go out there, find their own stories. So because of that, the science PR people, the scientists, the scientific organisations, they hold much more power. They put out the information there. The journalists, as we said, they just regurgitate it, that journalism effect. So the power more in the hands of the science establishment, good or bad. And at the end of the day, the biggest challenge, it all comes down to money, which most of these things do. And one of the biggest challenges facing the media is how we're going to fund journalism into the future when everything is readily available for free on the internet. So how are we going to fund it? And the first to go when there'll be cutbacks are the specialist journalists, the specialists being the science journalists. So at the end of the day, how might we fund those science journalists if in fact you feel that we still do need them? Or is it better that we just hear everything straight from the scientists? So again, something to think about. Anyway, bit of a whistle-stop tour. And more questions than answers, but that's what I was told to do. So I hope that's given you some food for thought. Thank you.